Let us rejoice in the one who leads us beside still waters, so that we might refresh ourselves. Christ our Shepherd guides us, that we might dwell in God's house forever. Let us pray. We pray that we might meet God here to celebrate divine mercy and grace, asking that God's Spirit inspire our praise and thanksgiving as we worship together. All this we seek in the name of the risen one who taught his disciples to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. A reading of Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long.
We continue to remember in our personal prayers Nancy Keefe, Penny Putnam, Tracy Welchel, Pastor Hazard, Thomas Matthews, Tom Virgo and his wife Elizabeth and their family, Cindy DeAndrea, Judy Zuliani, Jim and Joan Burke, Nicole Ciriello, Perry Green, Fred Paris, Glenn Wynn, Finn Daly, Kayla Daly, Daniela and Matteo Ciriello, living with a rare blood disorder, their parents and all medical staff devoting their lives to helping children, all who are afflicted with and by the virus, all innocents caught up in war. Let us pray. O Lord of the worlds, we come to you in thanksgiving for the care and attention you continue to give us as friends of your Son, Jesus Christ. We are proud to call Jesus our brother, recognizing the many joys that knowing him and walking with him have given to us. We are mindful of the sacrifices that he has made on our behalf and acknowledge the peace that he has brought us, the courage that he has bestowed upon us, and the purpose that he has infused us with as we walk in the pilgrim way. May Christ's love for all humankind be our inspiration to love one another, and may his righteousness and integrity so move us that others will see in Christ's own example a model for living lives of virtue and respect. Loving Father, we plead that all afflictions which we and those whom we love have recently endured might quickly become a thing of the past. May the scourges of ill health and failing spirit be lifted from us, granting us respite from all that would drain us of our resolve and our energies to successfully meet the challenges of any moment. Strengthen us, O Father, in our weaknesses. Nourish us in our emptiness in matters both spiritual and physical. Enliven us in our weariness when we feel spent and enfeebled. Offer to us, O God, the resolution to persevere in the paths leading to your kingdom as we endeavor, in the name of Christ, to be instructed in your will and intentions for our lives. O God of Concord, we pray that the path ahead of us, for us as individuals and for us as a people, might be increasingly harmonious. Remove from our minds any thoughts of vengefulness, vindictiveness, hostility, and malice, knowing that the Prince of Peace seeks to reign in our hearts, now and forever. May the calm that comes to us in the accents of the still small voice of Scripture possess us with a gentleness and forbearance worthy of those who wish to be known as your disciples. And may the tranquility of this season of Easter joy be a reminder that Christ gave himself selflessly that we might become heirs of everlasting faithfulness. For this we pray in Christ's name. Amen. Our scripture lesson this morning is from John's Gospel, chapter 10, verses 7 through 18. So again Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who come before me are thieves and bandits, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters by me will be saved, and will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand who is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. The hired hand runs away because a hired hand does not care for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that are not of this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it up again. I have received this command from my Father. Here ends the day's scripture lesson. All this month, we have been consistent in our description, our identification of Jesus as the risen one, and rightly so. Theologians through the centuries, however, have argued as to whether Jesus would have described himself in that manner. One of the most striking arguments against Jesus knowing that he would be resurrected was made, I think it was, by Irenaeus of Lyon in the early years of the second century. In other words, less than 100 years after the crucifixion. Irenaeus' argument was that it would not have been a true sacrifice on the part of Christ had he known for certain that God would bring him back to life. Well, poor Irenaeus, what a can of worms he opened, with dozens, hundreds of theologians accusing him almost of being a heretic for even entertaining such a thought. Yet Irenaeus' reputation as one of the earliest and greatest of the church fathers has remained intact. Be that as it may, all this raises the question of how Jesus defined himself. When Jesus says who he is, does he identify himself by saying what he does for himself? Is it by what his family background is? Is it by how much he earns in his trade? The answer to these possibilities is none of the above, because Jesus was always talking about himself in relation to those he came to in love. Indeed, there would have been no need for a savior had there been no one needing salvation. There was no need for him to proclaim himself Messiah. In fact, he strictly admonished his disciples not to do that, because confusion could easily result, since the popular view of the Messiah was someone who would exercise authority and dominion, not someone who would come to his people as their servant. In other words, when Jesus thought of himself, described himself, and reflected as to what his role in God's plan was all about, it was never all about him. It was rather all about us. Thus he came as the Good Shepherd, as one who cares for those who had been placed in his charge. And surprisingly, being a good shepherd made it clear to all who were listening to him that he viewed himself in much the same way as God the Father was depicted in the Psalms, in Ezekiel, and in so much of the rest of the Bible. And of course, in case we didn't put two and two together, Jesus swept away all ambiguity by saying, "I and the Father are one." But Jesus did not begin his ministry by drawing attention to himself, although he did accept the title of rabbi, teacher, from his followers. To be sure, the letter to the Hebrews would refer to Jesus as our great high priest. However, Jesus had set his sights elsewhere. And I think that, of all people, the poet Robert Frost might help us out here. Frost never really came across as a pious man. He certainly was not your typical Christian. He described himself, in fact, as an Old Testament Christian. As an Old Testament major in divinity school, I find that phrase intriguing, but it could probably have gotten Frost into as much trouble as Irenaeus of Lyon had gotten into back in the second century. Be that as it may, allow me to quote a bit of Frost to help us understand a bit better as to how Jesus might have understood himself. Two roads diverged in the woods, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference. In taking the road less traveled, Jesus was not entirely unique, though he did find himself in rather select company. Think for a moment about the kinds of people who are best remembered from Scripture. Who gives much thought these days to people like Laban, the father of Rebekah, or Naaman of Damascus, Zerubbabel of Jerusalem, or Rabshakeh the Assyrian? The distinguishing characteristic of all these people is that they lived for themselves. They followed the conventional pathway of putting self before others, profit before true value, skepticism before love. None of them could have recited those lines of Robert Frost in a heartfelt manner. When Jesus spoke of himself, it was entirely different. Everything about Christ was for others. He was the good shepherd who lives for his sheep, not a pretend shepherd who was in it for the cash. Jesus would die for his sheep, not run away from danger when it came near. That's why he is called the door of the sheep, because of an ancient practice in Palestine. When a good shepherd wandered with his flocks far afield in search of the best pastures, they sometimes found themselves at night far from the safety at home, where there would be no stockade to protect the animals. So a shepherd would herd his beasts through a narrow pass into a naturally enclosed area bounded on three sides by rocks or trees or whatever. Then the good shepherd, knowing that his cattle would be relatively safe, would lie down across the narrow entryway. Thus, no sheep could get out into danger. The good shepherd had, with his own body, closed the door to such an eventuality. Likewise, no danger in the form of wolves or lions could gain access to the sheep. They would have to encounter the good shepherd first. And thus it was how Jesus saw himself. His entire existence finds meaning in service, in what he does for those in his charge. Christ, indeed, could have been the inspiration for those words of our Old Testament Christian, Robert Frost, when he wrote, "Two roads diverged in the woods, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference." The real issue, however, is not how Christ saw himself, though that might make for some interesting theological discussions. The real question for us is, what road are you and I on? Scripture traditionally speaks of two roads, just as does Robert Frost. One road is wide, well-paved, well-traveled, easy access, no speed limit. But in the end, it goes nowhere. The other road is narrow. It hasn't been worn smooth by the feet of many travelers. It looks difficult and might even seem a little forbidding. With so few travelers, it might be tough to get help in case we run into trouble as we make our way along, or so we might think. But if we walk that road, you and I will be following Jesus himself. And with him as our good shepherd, that will make all the difference.
love of God the Father, the grace of God the Son, and the fellowship of God the Holy Spirit be with us and in our homes and with our loved ones, now and forevermore. Amen. Thank you.